5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
When I had come down this hill, I had seen this creature cross the road. It would have ripped my locked door from my truck, extracted me from my vehicle, and there wouldn't have been a damn thing I could have done about it.
This thing, I got to notice in its eyes. Its eyes was real, real evil, real sinister looking. You know, the look it was giving me.
Hello?
Get somebody out here.
What's going on now, sir?
That son of a bitch is about 6'9", I don't know.
Do you see him now, sir?
Yes, I'm looking right at him.
Uh-oh.
Welcome to Sasquatch Chronicles, a place where people share their encounters. Let's start the show. Welcome to the show, everyone. Thanks for being here tonight. Got a great show planned for you this evening. Going to be speaking to Nathan and Eric. And Nathan had a very interesting encounter when he was younger. He stumbled across one of these creatures sitting in a trail. Very interesting encounter. And, you know, when I talk to a lot of witnesses, it's interesting to listen to their impression of what's going on. I think that's important when you talk to people, to actually get the impression of what they experience. I know Eric had found tracks, he had heard wood knocks, and he had a strange experience when he was actually in the military with his Humvee being pushed down. And as Eric and I talked off the air, he talked about in this particular area where he did security for the military, he always had an eerie feeling in this area like he's being watched. So very interesting stuff tonight. Thanks for being here tonight, everyone. I really appreciate you listening. If you've had an encounter and you'd like to be on the show, shoot me an email. My email address is wes@sasquatchchronicles.com. And if you get a chance, check out the website, sasquatchchronicles.com. Get additional shows. I've been working on some additional things, but I'd like to actually produce more shows throughout the week. I know right now it's been between one and two shows a week, and I'm looking to do more. If you missed Friday night's show, very interesting encounter. There was a vocalization. It was actually a police officer who had the encounter, and he ended up shooting one of the creatures. And this is a scene from Planet of the Apes, but I thought it was applicable to the vocalization that they heard.
Stinking bar off me, you damn 38!
No!
And that's a vocalization that was their impression of what it was saying, almost like a no type yell. Very interesting encounter. Let's jump into it tonight. Nathan, thanks for being here tonight, man. I appreciate you coming on the show.
Yeah, no problem. My pleasure.
And if you would, for the audience, just kind of start from the very beginning. Talk about what you were out doing and what you ran into, what you experienced. Walk right into the whole encounter.
All right. Well, it was back in 2011. I was with my Boy Scout troop. We go on these 50-mile backpacking trips every summer. And this is my second one I was going on. And we were in the Rim Mountain area on the border of North Carolina and Tennessee. And we were 2 days in, 3 days into the hike, and camped out at night. And I got up from my tent to use the bathroom. And I had this strange feeling, like I needed to walk up the trail a bit. and we were camped on the slope of a mountain, and the trail was up the slope from us. So I went up to the trail, I turned right, and I start walking, and I came up over a slight rise, and kneeling down or squatting on the tonsures in the trail on the trail in front of me, there was this huge creature, and he was squatted down. He was as tall as I was, which was about 5'8" at that time. And he was looking right at me, and we made eye contact. And this lasted for maybe 15 seconds. I couldn't tell. Then he looks off to his right, and right as he does that, I start hearing branches breaking, big, strong branches breaking, coming down the hillside towards us. And he looks back at me, and he made this, he yelled at me, like a kind of sound. And it sounded to me like he was telling me to get the hell out of there. And that's exactly what I did. And he stood up, I stood up, and we both went off. He loped off, kind of almost floating through the woods, and I ran back to the campfire. And when I got to the campfire and got myself calmed down, I was gripping my hunting knife so hard that the blood stopped flowing to my fingers of that hand.
I would too, man. I'd be hanging on to any weapon I could at that point. Can you describe for the audience what you actually saw? What did the creature look like?
It looked like a man, but the shoulders and the body were thick. And the way he was squatted down, he had one fist on the ground, squatted on his haunches. And the head, on a person's head, it only goes up so far past the eyes. And this guy, the head was up a lot farther than a man's was, and it was cone-shaped. And there was hair all over its body. It was like a dark, kind of wiry black hair. I couldn't really tell what color because the moonlight wasn't that great, but it was certainly dark hair, and you couldn't see skin through it. And when he stood up, the arms came down a little bit past its knees. It was real light on its feet, despite being that size. And when he stood up, he was at least twice as tall as I was. I'd say 10 or 11 feet.
What did you think you were looking at the time?
Well, when I first saw it, I thought I just walked up on a bear. But when I made eye contact with it, and it moved its head a little bit to look at me, I didn't know what I was seeing. And for some reason, you know, when I walked up that trail, I had that feeling of, you know, that it was like being somebody tied a rope to the center of my chest and pulled me up there. But I felt pretty calm looking at it. And when it looked at me and I realized it's not a bear, it wasn't like, you know, it's not a bear, what the hell is this? I need to get out of here. It's like, oh, well, I guess that's not a bear. You know, it wasn't a fear thing.
So you would say it was more kind of manlike when you saw it?
The face was. I got a clear look at the face. The eyes were set closer together. The nose was flattened, but still man-like enough. The mouth was more of a slit. There weren't any lips, and the entire face was covered with hair. The eyes were very dark and very intense. I didn't see any eyes shine, but there was no light shining on them.
And when he vocalized at you, do you think that was a threat, or do you think something else was going on?
It sounded to me like he was trying to warn me, because right as he did that, you know, I heard those branches breaking up the hill to my right. And, you know, what happened was he looked up there, looks right back at me, and he made that noise, and it hit me in the chest like a freight train. You know, you could feel the sound, and I just had to get out of there. It sounded like he was telling me, you need to leave.
So for the audience listening, you heard something else coming down that you never got a good look at, but something, it sounds like something else was coming down. Is that right?
Yeah, that's right. Either it was a gigantic boulder rolling down that hill, or there was some kind of animal, I don't know what, coming down that hill. but I heard branches breaking and huge crashing footfalls in the leaves. I'm shaking right now just thinking about it because it really sounded, you know, big. Like, you know, in Virginia, you don't have anything bigger than a black bear, and they don't get bigger than 600-700 pounds. So, and whatever this was, it was breaking small, like, you know, young trees, not saplings, but young trees as it came down the hill.
Yeah, your encounter fascinates me. And when you and I were talking the other day, I was really fascinated by it because, and correct me if any of this is wrong, you're not going to hurt my feelings by any means, but it was almost kind of, the creature never really came towards you. The creature never really aggressively came at you. Even at your impression at the time, which, you know, when I listen to people tell their encounters, usually the witness's impressions are right on. And in your case, it wasn't a situation of, hey, if you come any closer, I'm going to kill you. It doesn't really sound like there was any aggression, almost like he was warning you to get out of there.
The look on his face when he was looking at me, the expression was kind of like a concerned parent, you know, like you just found some kid out in the middle of the woods and you're worried, you know, what the heck are they doing out there?
Yeah, so he didn't give you the stink eye. There was nothing like that.
No, I didn't at any time feel like he was going to, you know, move towards me in an aggressive manner.
And so what happened next? So he did this vocalization. Did the creature get up and walk away, or were you already in a full sprint or turning around and heading back to your camp?
He got up and kind of loped off, something between a run and a jog, but very smooth, not like a man would. You know, when we run, we bounce, and this guy wasn't bouncing. It was like he was on a level run, and I ran right. And once he got up, I figured, well, he's not going to help me anymore at this point. So I made my run for it. That was the fastest 100 yards I ever sprinted in the dark in the woods on the mountain.
Yeah, I bet. What made you? Why do you think you decided to walk down that trail that night?
You know, I've done a lot of thinking about why I did, because I only had to walk maybe 15 feet to be behind a tree, but it was really like being pulled by a rope in my chest. That's the feeling, what it was like. Like, it was a certain, it was like a irresistible curiosity.
And you hadn't heard anything at that point, correct?
Nope. It was your average night in the woods, just crickets, and I think there was an owl hooting earlier that night I was listening to as I was falling asleep. So, you know, nothing out of the ordinary.
Now, when you go back to camp, do you tell anyone about this encounter?
No. The last 2 days of the trip, I didn't really talk to anybody. I was shaken up. I stayed quiet, and even my scoutmaster, I remember he asked me, you know, something wrong? Are you having trouble with the other boys or something? You know, because I wasn't talking. And I said, no, it's no problem. It's no problem. But, you know, I wasn't chatting, you know, playing grab ass like I usually was at that age. So I just kind of kept quiet and went home. And you know, a few days later, I was my old self again. But it really shook me.
Yeah, no, I would imagine. I mean, God, that would have shook me up, especially when you run into it. But it's an interesting encounter because a lot of times when people come in contact with these creatures like how you did, and I don't know if you caught it off guard, it's sitting in the middle of the trail. I think it's interesting how you say it was kind of sitting on its haunches, because I've talked to a lot of other witnesses that have seen that, where that's exactly how they describe it. It wasn't sitting down like a man. It was kind of sitting on its haunches to where it could pop back up and come at you if it wanted to. But what's interesting about your encounter is there was no aggression in your encounter. It's almost kind of like the vocalization was like, go away, get away from here. There's something else coming down the hill, go away. You know, and you would have known if there would have been aggression, that thing would have bluff charged you, would have stood up, it would have came at you. What was your impression as you were looking at this thing and it was looking back at you? You had mentioned concerned parent. Do you think as you looked into this thing, what was your feelings just kind of looking at this thing, besides what the hell is this?
I mean, it was kind of like, you know, there was a certain amount of awe at the sheer size of it. But there was also curiosity. You know, when I was a little kid, I read this this little kid's book about a kid who goes out in the woods trying to help his dad find Sasquatch or something. And so I knew a little bit about it, but you know, I never took any stock in it. And seeing it right there in front of me, it was kind of like a, whoa, what? but it was, I feel like it was surprised but pleased to see me, and I was surprised but somewhat pleased to see it. It was a very positive encounter, and I've heard a lot of encounters. I've listened to your show quite a bit, and a lot of the encounters are very negative, you know, Sasquatch throwing rocks at people or chasing them off a trail or, you know, running them down for picking huckleberries after dark. But this one looked like he didn't mind being around people, or at least me. I wasn't very threatening back then. I was a stick.
Yeah, almost like it was, it didn't seem like it was intimidated by it all by you coming down. And, you know, it throws me, one of the things I know I've lightened up a lot on people who say they've seen these things and they say that they're people, where you'll talk to a lot of groups where they'll say, oh, these things are people. And I used to be like, oh, no, you're wrong. But the more and more encounters I listen to, the more and more encounters, you know, you have to listen to what people are saying. And I know in your encounter, as you and I were talking and we hung up the other day, I was thinking, not only is there intelligence, but there was almost kind of compassion, somewhat compassion in your encounter. Because whatever was coming down that hill, I mean, he could have growled at you. He could have roared at you. He could have easily have scared you off. But that wasn't really the vocalization he did. It was more of a, I don't know, how would you describe it?
It was like when you're crossing the road and your dad yells, you get out of the road, get out of the road, because there's a car coming. It was that kind of thing, you know. It was that kind of, you know, get out of here, something bad's going to happen. And those words almost formed in my head when he made that noise.
Yeah, and that's interesting. I always find it interesting, our perceptions of these things. I was just talking to a guy the other day, and he was being dragged off by one, way different than your description. I almost think he ran into a different type, but he had shot it. And the guy that was walking up on the scene, his buddy that he was hunting with, he said, you know that scene in Planet of the Apes when it goes, no, when it yells no?
Mm-hmm.
He said that's almost kind of what he heard, almost kind of a no. And, you know, I don't know if that's what actually it was saying or if that was his impression, but I think the witness's impressions are important when you're talking to people. Has it affected you at all as far as going back out? I mean, did it worry you at all going back out?
It did a bit. But you know, I'm still an avid backpacker. And I'm just starting to hunt now. I do black powder hunting. I'm actually about to go out to the same, you know, I'm going to go back to the same spot this summer when I finish up my semester of classes. We'll see how that goes. But, you know, I'm scared because of whatever was coming down the hill. I also feel a bit safer in the woods knowing that something, whatever that was looking out for me when I was a kid. Because I really do feel it was looking out for me.
Yeah, and be careful. Well, one question I want to ask you. What state did this happen in, just out of curiosity?
Tennessee-Virginia border, right on the borderline, about a mile from it, in the northwestern corner or northeastern corner of the state of Tennessee.
Well, be careful when you go out. You know, when you go back out, please be careful. You know, the one that you ran into may not be the one you run into next time. You know what I mean? You can't judge every encounter with these things the way you first run into them. I know, like, Bob Garrett's a perfect example that, you know, the ones he ran into in Colorado, he thought were kind creatures, very gentle, you know, not trouble at all. Then he gets to Texas and realizes, wow, these things are monsters. So you never really know the kind you run into. You know, it's kind of the old pit bull theory. I have a pit bull. I love my dog to death. But just because I can walk up and tackle my dog, and I'm not going to get hurt doesn't mean I'm going to go up to someone else's pit bull and play rough with it, or, you know, because they might just, you know what I'm trying to say. I guess I'm just rambling, but you know what I'm trying to say. Like, please be careful. Realize not every one of them is going to be like that. Not every creature you run into is going to have that mentality of, hey, I'm looking out for you. I would say most of the time that's not what you run into. But you do run into it from time to time. They're not all monsters. And I say that on the show, and I try and get that through to the audience when I talk, that, you know, if most people think that I'd put a bullet in every single one of them I saw, and that's not true. There are good ones, there are bad ones. It kind of depends on what you run into, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I feel the same way. You know, I feel like the Sasquatch are numerous enough that either as individuals or groups, they have different personalities, maybe even different cultures across the country. So you could run into a group of them that are, you know, man-eating, you know, take women and girls, like the Native Americans would say. Or you could run into a group or an individual like the one I ran into that was looking out. You know, I almost hope to see it again. I've always wondered what it'd be like if I did. You know, the thing is that I feel like if I did, it wouldn't be too interested in hanging around, you know. But I feel like I owe it something, whatever it is.
That makes sense to me. I mean, I get what you're saying, and you know, I would probably have a different feeling if I had an encounter like yours towards them. I might be a little bit more not so hard-hearted towards them if I had your type of encounter. So I definitely get what you mean. But, you know, keep in mind, too, it's like I tell people, treat it like you would a grizzly bear. Treat it just like you would the exact same way a grizzly bear. Now, are all grizzly bears killing machines? No, they're not. I saw a video on Facebook the other day of this lady that... her mother-in-law was in a wheelchair. They were sitting on the beach, and here comes a grizzly bear and her cubs walking down the beach. And I'm thinking, and this lady is an idiot, because I'm thinking, I hope she's not listening, but I think she's an idiot. I'm thinking, get your mother-in-law slowly back out of the area, give the grizzly mother and her cubs room to go by, and hope to God that she doesn't turn on you. And wish, I mean, basically say a prayer and hope for the best. Well, what was interesting is she never moved. She just sat there. And she filmed the whole thing. This grizzly bear walks right past. Grizzly bear mom and two cubs walk within probably 10 feet, mm-hmm. and they just keep on going. The mother grizzly bear doesn't even flinch, just keeps walking down. And so I guess I tell you that to say this. You never know what... The temperament, you never know if someone had told me that and I hadn't seen the video, I would have called BS on the whole thing. But after watching the video, I was shocked. I was like, wow, I can't believe that this grizzly bear didn't kill this woman. And so I guess what I'm trying to say is the same thing applies with these creatures. You have to be careful because you don't really understand what the boundaries are. You don't really understand what, you know, you wouldn't think smiling at a gorilla would piss it off, but it does, because they look at it as a sign of aggression. So you never know really when you're going to cross the line. And when you cross the line with these things, you're in a very bad position. But I don't blame you, man. I mean, I get what you're saying. I'd probably want to get back out there too and run into it again. Who the hell knows what was coming down that hill? Something probably bigger and badder and worse than what you ran into. And he was just kind of telling you, get back to camp, get the hell out of here.
You know, one of my theories is, you know, I'd heard this I think it was Chickasaw legend, that the hairy men and the dog men were at war, for whatever reason, and the hairy men lived in the mountains to the north of the Chickasaw, which would put them pretty much square in the Appalachian Range, and the dog men lived in the open land to the south, and I was thinking, you know, maybe it was a dog man coming down that hill after the Sasquatch or after me, because, you know, it was too big for a bear. You know, I spend a lot of time in the woods. I've run into a lot of bears. Black bears aren't going to come charging down a hill at you unless you're kicking their cubs or something crazy like that, you know?
Yeah, no, it takes a lot to piss a black bear off. And most of the time they want nothing to do with you. I mean, they literally really want nothing to do with you. And they're usually gone. They're not going to be coming down the hill. See, who knows what was coming down that hill? I've heard those same legends. I've talked to a lot of Native Americans, and they talk about the Sasquatch and these dogmen. They have like a weird name for the dogmen. I can't remember top of my head what it is, but they have a strange name.
It's something hard to pronounce.
It's something hard to pronounce. I can't remember what the name of it is off the top of my head. I'll have to write it down so I don't sound like a moron, but They do have a name for the dog man, but it's just weird. I don't even know how to. Anyway, but yeah, no, I've heard those same legends to where they don't get along. They're always at war with each other. And the legends that I've heard are usually down south, is where I've heard those from some of the Native Americans. And they talk about them being physical beings. You know, sometimes when you talk to Native Americans, it's hard to. Are they talking about the spirit world? Are they talking about. But they're very cut and dry when they talk about these two types of creatures, especially down south, as being physical beings and physical creatures. And yeah, man, what an amazing encounter. I bet it changed your life. And, you know, I don't blame you for wanting to get back out there. Let me know when you go back out there. Let me know if you find any prints. Let me know if you find anything while you're out there. I'd love to do a follow-up with you.
Yeah, sure, definitely. I'll come back with some pictures and I'll take some pictures of the spot and everything for you.
Yeah, no, I'd love to see it. I'd love to see the pictures. And I can't thank you enough for coming on the show, man. Thank you so much for taking the time to share the encounter, you know, with the audience and with me. And it's an amazing encounter. After you and I hung up the other day, I was thinking, I wonder what drew him out to go look for this thing. Or what, not to go look for this thing, but what I mean is, I almost think there's something primal inside of us that we had at one time when these things were around that put us on high alert, that put us on, it's almost something wired in our brains that put us on this high alert. You know, if that's what happened to you, I don't know, but it's a fascinating encounter. And I'm just glad that you had a halfway decent encounter instead of one that could have gone bad pretty quick.
Yeah, because that guy, he could have picked me up and plucked me limb from limb if he wanted to.
Yeah, and when you see them, you don't realize how, you know, you being 5'8 at the time and it's on its haunches just as tall as you are. It doesn't sound like much, but then after it stands up, you realize, wow, this thing's twice as tall as I am. This thing's a monster as far as size goes.
Oh, yeah.
And it's really hard to, it's hard to describe that to people, isn't it, until you see it?
Yeah, it's hard to you know, really convey the sheer enormousness of something like that. Like, you know, you've seen big animals before, elephants and everything, but to see something in the form of a man, you know, standing on two legs, that's twice the size of you, it's intimidating and it's awe-inspiring. I can't describe it really.
Yeah. Well, thanks for coming on, man. I appreciate it.
Yeah, no problem. Thanks for having me.
Thanks, Nathan. I appreciate you coming on, man. Let's jump to Eric. Hey, Eric, thanks for coming on the show, man. I appreciate you being here tonight.
Not a problem, Wes. Thanks for having me, brother.
If you would, for the audience, just kind of walk right into your encounter. Tell us what happened, what you experienced, and what you saw.
Yeah, sure. That's not a problem. Basically, what it was is I was on recovery from a surgery. And so kind of to get to my little sanctuary, as I call it, my aunt lives south of Buffalo, New York, by about, I don't know, 25, 30 minutes, and it's really wooded down there, and it's like in the ski region near Kissing Bridge and all that. So, excuse me. I went down there with my kids, my son and my daughter, and then the girl, obviously, at the time, her son came with me. So, we're in the woods. You know, I'm recovering 2 months after a knee surgery, so I wasn't too mobile, but it was just nice to be out there. It's this is March 1st of 2014. My surgery was January 3rd of the same year, so 60 days in, I'm still recovering. And we're out in the woods. My daughter and I are the first ones out there, and there's a trail back behind their house. And we're, you know, just enjoying the snow that was on the ground. And, of course, it's buffalo weather, you know, in the the winter off Lake Erie. That's the snow belt. So we're down there just enjoying nature pretty much. And I kind of like fell into a snow pile, like the snow gave way underneath, of course, the bad leg, the bad knee goes into the snow drift. Well, I decided to go down, kind of like roll into it type thing, so I don't, you know, hurt myself anymore. And my daughter got a kick out of it, so she brought a stick over to help me, you know, like a walking stick type to stand up. So I get up, there's a little wooden bench somebody made on the trail, and I go sit on this, you know, 2x4 bench and just kind of relax and just make sure my leg was working right, stuff like that. And all of a sudden, out of nowhere, we hear a wood knock. And it was a distinct, clear, like a baseball bat hitting a tree. So we look in the direction. I'm like, huh, that's weird. Maybe it's just, you know, kids, you know, there's some kids on this area where the houses are, and it's like kind of development where it's really nice, actually. It's a very wealthy neighborhood, and there's like an acre to acre and a half between each house, and they had to keep it wooded to live there. So didn't think nothing of it. And that was like in a northern direction from our position. But then 5 minutes later, all of a sudden there's another very distinct, very clear wood knock. Again, saw like a baseball bat hitting a tree. Now this came from behind us. So me and my daughter, we turn and look. Like, okay, maybe someone's chopping wood. You know, everyone's got wood burning stoves out in that part of West New York. And so I figure someone's cutting wood or they're, you know, they're into their wood pile, stuff like that. 5 minutes later, same spot, position one. Pow! I'm like, okay, maybe it's kids in the woods hitting trees. We used to do it when me and my cousin were down there. And sure enough, 4 or 5 minutes later, position two. I mean, almost like clockwork, just pow! I'm like, okay, this is getting a little bit too coincidental. And position one goes again. Crack! I'm like, okay, now this is the fifth time. So I'm like, well, I see him doing it on, you know, watching the Bigfoot shows and the, oh, was it Monster Class and all that. So I do a whoop noise. Didn't get any reply. Up to this is six. But then about 4 or 5 minutes after I do it, there's the wood knock. I'm like, okay. So my son comes running out this time because they were getting their boots and stuff on. And the boys come running. My son's like, Dad, what's that? I'm like, shushing him. I'm like, Joe, we're hearing wood knocks out here. He goes, well, I just heard a whoop noise. I'm like, well, that was me. And sure enough, crack, there's another one. And this goes on and on and on for a good hour. Almost every 4 or 5 minutes apart, there's these distinct wood knocks. Pow, pow, pow. I'm like, okay, this is getting strange. I want to say it was like around the 12th wood knock. Position two hits twice. It was a distinct crack, crack. I'm like, okay, well, now that was different. And as soon as that one went, anywhere from 3 to 5 minutes between each wood knock, the dog across the road, I would say no more than, 100 yards, not even, maybe 75 yards from where we were standing, the dog gets into this really defensive, aggressive bark. And it just like when a mailman walks up to your door, you know, and the dog in the window starts going crazy. This dog just starts going nuts. But you hear the guy, all of a sudden you hear a guy's voice go, hey, get in here. Dog shuts up, obviously goes inside. When that dog went inside, I don't know, 30 seconds later, crack. I'm like, you got to be kidding me. As soon as position three now cracked across the road, I'm like, oh, we're in an L-shaped ambush. I did 22 years in the Army. And I had point one to the north, point two to the south, and point three was to my west. I'm like, oh, this is not good. I got three of them here. And as soon as that thought popped in my head, I started gathering my kids back to my aunt's house. Now, we were only like 45 feet away, 50 feet away, so we weren't that far. So I gather them up. We get back to the house. We're on like pretty much the back porch. And as soon as we got to the porch, position two, I don't know, maybe a minute within the knock, position two knocks. 30 seconds later, as we're walking, we're looking at where point two is to the south of us. Point one knocks, and that's it. Now, my rookie mistake was, rather than me being on my cell phone all the time, actually sending and writing the report to the BFRO, and I was like at 1500, point one was in this grid azimuth, 1504, point two in this grid azimuth. I'm doing like I'm calling on military targets pretty much, so an artillery strike. That's what I've done for 20 years, so that's the only way I could put it down. But I was like, very matter of fact, the time, when the knock was, how many knocks, the area it was coming from, what the weather was like, no wind, stuff like that. It was just going on and on and on and on. I wish I still had that report because that was very detailed on my end. Never heard back from them, nothing of the sort. And who knows, maybe they get a ton of reports. You know, I'm not to judge them, or I'm not trying to put nobody down, but, you know, stuff happens and whatnot. But I would give anything to have that report back, because that was just my eyes that day. I was pretty much in shock the rest of the evening from that. I didn't have a feeling of being threatened, but it's like, what? It's like something just jumped off of a page in a book in front of you and landed right there in front of you. Just crazy.
Yeah, that is crazy. Did you ever go back out to that area and take a look around, see if you could find footprints or anything like that?
I did go back a couple weeks later, and this is during the winter of 2014. We had that, we got some decent snow. And down there, what it would do is it would snow, it would melt a little bit, it would snow, it would melt, snow melt. And there's a really distinct, snowpack down there. So by the time we were down there, when this happened, I mean, there's no tracks to be found. We did go look, but I was very limited. So by the time I got out there, it was, I would say, mid-spring, so there's a little bit of snow. I really couldn't see nothing. But that day that we were down there, I sent you the pictures of that tree. It's literally, I measured it. It's 45 feet behind my aunt's back porch. It has a branch. And when you look at this branch, it was snapped, twisted, and pulled. And this branch is 12 feet off the ground. My son, I had him stand under it for height reference. And he was 6 foot tall at the age of 15. This thing is like twice as tall as he is. I mean, it's 11 feet, 8 inches, I think, when I measured it, from the bottom of that branch to the ground. And there was no sign of that branch being on the ground. When we got the picture, when I took the picture, it was a fresh, clean break. A buddy of mine is an arborist here. He was in my Army National Guard unit. We were engineers. And he took a look at that branch, and he goes, that's not normal. He goes, that's not cut. He goes, that was like something grabbed it and ripped it down. You can see how it's like opened up and it's rolled, and I've heard Kumbo and Baron them talk about that all the time too. So, of course, I found that out a couple years later when I started listening to their shows. But I mean, it was just something I found strange, and gone back out there a few times, and I found some very interesting tree formations. Of course, with all the leaf litter up there with a lot of maples, it's hard to get footprints. But when the snow falls, I'll definitely be out in that area looking, because I did find a very interesting tree formation. I call it the upside down delta, like a woven delta, because it looks like a pyramid. Or not a pyramid, but like a triangle, I mean. And I sent you those pictures too. You had two law enforcement officers that found something very similar to that, and they had it on video. So that's definitely another area I want to go back and look at that and go up in those hills and down into the little draws or the hollers and stuff like that, and basically follow the creek line, the water, and see what happens down there.
And you actually went out in that general area driving, and you found a track line. Do you want to tell us about that?
Oh, yeah. The track line, actually, that was a lot closer to home. That one, now where my aunt lives in South Erie County there, it's, you know, very hilly. You're starting to get into the hills to go into the Allegheny Mountains. Of course, our mountains are nothing like what they have out there west, or out there in the west, I should say. But the track line I actually found almost exactly a year to the day later. I was working for AAA. That's when we had our polar vortex hit the East Coast, and we were like 30 degrees below zero, 20 degrees below zero. So me being for AAA, I was very busy with changing batteries, jump-starting cars, changing tires, pulling a lot of ditches, stuff like that, with typical AAA work. So my day off, I'm enjoying it. I had to go into the VA hospital to have them look at my knee. That's who did my surgery. So going to the hospital, or heading towards the hospital, I should say, I stop at a coffee shop. I get my iced cappuccino, and rather than fight to get on the main drag, which is Transit Road, to get on Millersport, I'll take the back way. I'll go downtown on a creek road. I'm driving, big, nice houses out that way, right along the creek on both sides of the road. Lots of, you know, nice kept land between them, and they got a lot of woods behind them on both sides. I'm no more than, I had to be maybe at the most quarter of a mile from the main strip. There was a house, and as I'm driving by, I just happen to look at the house. There are these distinct trackways that are across the front lawn, goes over the driveway and comes to the road, or comes from the road and across, whichever way it goes. I see this, I hit the brakes, and now I'm like, you have got to be kidding me. So I hit my brakes in my Tahoe, I pull over to the side of the road, I got my four-ways on. I'm like, I just did not see that. Click, click, go into reverse, I back up. I'm sitting in front of this person's house around 10 o'clock in the morning, 10:30 around there. I'm looking like, this can't be real. So I'm looking at them, I'm like, those look very far apart. Now, when I was in the woods writing that report, rookie mistake number one, when I finally realized what it was, I should have been recording these wood knocks as best as I could with my cell phone, either through a video or even, you know, maybe with a recorder. Well, I back up. I'm thinking, okay, I want to look at these things, but how am I going to get out on this person's front lawn and measure these things? So I actually have my toolbox in the back of my truck. So I get my tape measure, and as I open up the back of my truck, my big yellow Carhartt AAA jacket sitting there. I'm like, I'll pretend I'm with the city or the town or, you know, Department of Transportation, the highway. So I jump out, get my measuring tape, and I kind of like run up the driveway real quick. And I measured the impressions, which they're 20 inches long by 10 inches wide. The trackway that went across the front lawn, the long part, those were 6 feet apart. They're anywhere from 72 to 74 inch strides from either leading edge to leading edge or trailing edge to trailing edge, whichever, which way they're going. I made sure I measured the same spot on each. So if I'm looking with the track right in front of me, if it's to the right, I went from the tip of that right one to the tip of the next one over to me to the right, to that right side, far right side tip. So doing that, that's where I got to 72 to 74 inches apart. When I went to where on the other side of the driveway, between two trees, you can see they're 6 feet apart, but I measured those ones. Then there are two strides. One was 84 inches, and one was 86 inches between each stride. So it was like between the trees, it took like two real big strides. Now I'm looking, I'm like, okay, is this, now I'm trying to debunk it, is this a rabbit jumping? There's no idea it could be. But there were no distinct rabbit prints in the bottom of these tracks. So I'm like, oh, okay. And then in the one picture I sent you, you can see where a small animal came up through the print after it was made. I'm just like, no, no, no. And of course, rookie mistake number two, I did take the measurements. I have the tape measure in my truck right now. It's sitting in my center console. And I didn't take pictures of them. I was just nervous. I didn't want someone to say, hey, who are you? Why are you on my property? Stuff like that. So I was trying to get all this within a 10-15 minute window. And then I just took off from there again, just like, okay, lightning does strike twice, you know? So it definitely opened my eyes to a lot of stuff, a lot of stuff.
Especially when you find evidence, you know, when you start finding evidence or you hear wood knocks, you know, you start to find little bits and pieces of, you know, outside of a sighting, you start to find and collect evidence. It really does open your eyes. Yeah, I was just talking with another guy about that. He was saying he didn't really buy into any of this until he had his encounter, and it really opened his eyes. I know he's looking into dog man. He's looking into a lot of other things he would have never dreamed of looking into because he had a hard time buying into it. And I think once you open your eyes and kind of see what's going on, it kind of comes back full circle. And I know it came back full circle for you. You had something strange happen when you were a kid, or didn't you, Eric? And all of this kind of brought back memories?
Yeah, actually, it did. This is when I was telling you about it, this is where it comes full circle for me. So first we hear the wood knocks, and I'm just like struck by lightning. A year later, actually after the wood knocks too, a real quick story. We were camping with the Boy Scouts at my Scoutmaster's property down there. And he took the boys, because again, I'm still after my surgery. I'm basically maintaining the camp at the cabin, and he took the boys and the other scout leader, they took them for a hike. So the two leaders and like six kids are up in the woods, and they're, you know, you can hear them chomping away and off and going up the hill. 40 minutes into their hike, I know they're like basically down by the one little creek he has on his property. I hear a very loud crack of wood, like a tree branch breaking or a tree falling down. And just like the same the day I heard the wood knocks, there was no wind. There were no animal sounds. There was not a bird, no crows, no movement of any kind of small critters. And usually out there, there's a lot of deer, a lot of rabbit, a lot of squirrel. So that was another little encounter. And then I was relaying all this information to my father probably about a year ago, and I'm telling him the stuff that, you know, me and the kids have heard, and my son has been even to the one major Boy Scout camp, and he's heard whistles, wood knocks, two separate times, 2 different years, kids actually reported seeing something very large, black, muscular, like a wrestler or a bodybuilder, standing down, coincidentally, in the one campsite that they restrict now, down by the creek, Camp Red Jacket. So when I was relaying all this information to my father about what happened at my Aunt Marilyn's, that's his, one of his older sisters. As I'm telling these stories, I'm telling about the footprints and the stuff that the kids have heard, this is where my boomerang effect comes in. All of a sudden, it hits me. I've had this memory pop up every now and then. Like, why do I think about this? Why am I remembering when we saw that big deer at my aunt's house, Pine Street? Why is it coming back into my head now all of a sudden? It's just, and this would just occur randomly throughout my years growing up as a teenager, when I was in the military. Why do I keep picturing this scene in my head? When I'm talking at Maryland, my cousin Josh, we were about, I think I was 9 and he was 6. So we were young. And I used to love going to my aunt's house all the time. Always loved playing in the woods. You know, typical kid stuff. We had the toy guns. We're playing army. We're walking around with sticks. We're fighting swords. We're fighting these imaginary dragons and goblins and stuff like that. Just, you know, kids being kids without cell phones and iPads, pretty much. So that's when imagination ruled the world. When we were down there, we were in the creek down behind the house, and at the most 150 feet from the back of the house, my aunt's house, and it does actually slope down to the creek. So we're down there, and I'm kind of crouched down, and I'm turning the stones to look for salamanders and crayfish and, you know, stuff like that, maybe frogs, whatever we find down there. All of a sudden, my cousin, he's standing just to the left of me, and all of a sudden I hear him do that, you know, that gasp of like, what, you know, and I look up at him, and I see where he's looking. I actually see a form of this dark, it was like a dark brown object, but it was tall. It was very tall, and I see it moving, going from peeking out to behind the tree. I see this. My cousin runs. I'm like, I'm not sticking around. I said, I just saw something huge and hairy. I'm right behind him. So we're running up this slight little grade of a hill, and we're moving. And we get into we go up the back porch, we're in the house, we go up the spiral staircase to my aunt's where the kitchen is on the second floor. And we go running in, and we're like, and he's yelling, Mom, Mom, Mom. I'm like, hey, Marilyn, you should see this. And we're just like, you know, two young kids, we're all hyped up. We're like, wait, we couldn't believe what we just saw. And we're like, we just saw this big thing out there, this big, large thing. And I remember distinctly my cousin saying, this thing was bigger than Uncle Mike. Now that's my father. He stands 6'5". So we're 9, 6 years old. 6'5" is like, you know, looking at Shaquille O'Neal for us. But when I went back out just a couple of months ago, I found the spot in the creek, same spot. I could see the same tree. And I remember looking over there. We went and measured that tree. This thing was up around the 8.5 to 9 foot range of the one branch. And as we were telling the story, I think my aunt knew what we were talking about, but she kind of, I don't always, manipulation would be the proper word, or guided our thought process, or I guess that'd be the same thing. But basically, she kind of, well, you guys saw a very large deer, right? You saw a big deer behind the tree. And then we looked, we're like, was that a deer? Yeah, I think it was a deer. So we're 9 and 6, we didn't know. And then she's like, well, why don't you guys stay in for lunch, go wash your hands, and, you know, you guys can go play, you know, downstairs, and, you know, you can get the board games and all stuff. So that's what we ended up doing. We never went back to the woods that weekend, which is basically their backyard, but she didn't let us back out.
Did you ever go back and ask your cousin or talk to your cousin about that incident?
No, actually, I've never brought that up to my cousin Joshua. It's, you know, I'll bring it up one of these times. I don't know if I need to get the courage to say it or what the deal is, but I want to talk to him, his sister, because I also want to talk to my aunt and uncle. I was just out there, like I said, just a few months ago, and it was, I don't know, about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. So it's winter time. The sun's starting to set a little bit. And my aunt and uncle are like, well, you have a cell phone on you, right? I'm like, yeah, I got a cell phone. Why? I'm like, well, just make sure you have your cell phone on you when you're out in the woods. I'm like, okay. And I'm like, okay, why? Why do you want to know if I have a cell phone? So I didn't go far. I just went down to the creek and just, you know, just enjoying a little walk, enjoying the trees. I really wasn't looking for too much. But there was a distinct wood knock further out in the woods. And Yeah, again, it's a very it's a productive site. You go down there, you see stuff. You will get interaction of some sort down there because, again, the dog, another dog across the road, I don't know if it's the same one, it started barking, not as vicious, but it was barking, and also you heard like a bit of a whimper noise. I'm like, uh-oh. So I was like, yeah, I think I'm going to go back inside the house now. So
yeah,
between where the Scoutmaster's camp is, well, his property, I should say, in Cuba, New York, I actually had some locals around there. I actually got the courage up to ask them there, too, and they're like, well, Black Creek is known for sightings, and it's always, there's always action in Cuba, New York. We went the weekend before Easter. We were down there. We had a little camp out, and I was standing out there at 5 o'clock in the morning, and, you know, a lot of little water. We went to dinner the night before at the One Little Barn Grill, and a couple beers, a lot of water, some pops, stuff like that. And, well, 5 o'clock, I'm out there, you know, Mother Nature calls, and I hear two woo noises, and it sounded like Ric Flair was down the hill and across on the other one. And I'm like, oh, that's new. I'm like, I've never heard that before. I'm like, all right, I'm going back in the house, going back to bed. So, oh, yeah, just very interesting one. It's very, very, it doesn't happen every time, but yeah, it happens.
Well, be careful when you're out, man.
Oh, yeah. Oh, you. My eyes are always open now. My head's on a swivel.
Yeah.
My head's always on a swivel in the woods now.
And I appreciate you coming on and sharing the experiences very much.
Oh, no problem, dude. No problem. Like I said, big fan of the show. I found you guys after I had the experience. And, you know, I used to watch the TV shows. And then once I started listening to you guys and... I mean, I have more stories too. I have one that stopped the tap from my friend. I said, I told you one time we had something happen at the nuclear plant out near Nest, north of Rochester, New York. You know, we're armed to the teeth. We have body armor on, and we're sitting out front with the National Guard as like a security force. And we had something happen to us where something pushed the back of our Humvee down. Me and Sergeant Diaz looked at each other. We jumped out. There's nothing out there, but we were right next to the wood line that was not too far from this nuclear plant. So I didn't think anything of it at the time, but after hearing how fast these things are, how strong they are, how they can crawl up on you, like basically low crawl like the military does, whatever had the power to push that Humvee down, and I mean it was distinctly pushing the back of a Hummer down, and this is the military grade one, the H1s, and just, well, civilian H1s, but yeah, that was an eye opener. I locked and loaded right then and there. I saw nothing. He saw nothing. We both went out each side of the vehicle. And that, to this day, still stumps me. Could it have been? Maybe. I don't know. But there's always, in those wood lines, that's where I always felt like I was being watched. I hated driving through that wood line to get to the other site that we had to monitor and patrol. I hated doing the dismount from there because you had to walk down, go over bridge, through the wood line to get to the shoreline of Lake Ontario. I never felt easy over there. That's where I always had, like, eyes on target, where now is a target, so... That's still one that, I mean, right now I'm getting the chills just thinking about it.
Yeah, that is interesting. You know, like you and I talked the other day, I've talked to hunters and that have been out and have had experience that. I had one that actually saw a Sasquatch jump on the bed of his truck and it dropped the shocks down, dropped everything down. He looked back and it leaped off and it was gone. It makes you wonder what that type of behavior is all about. And I would imagine... You know, you wouldn't mess with two military guys out there. You guys are armed to the teeth, and in an H1, you know, a person's not going to go jump on the. Well, a person couldn't even drop down an H1, jumping on the back of it, like you described.
Yeah, we tried. Me and Sergeant. First, I jumped with full battle rail. All it was just a big thud landing in the back of the Hummer. Then he climbed up to the rollover beam behind the driver's seat, the passenger seat in the front. We both jumped together. We did not make this thing move. I don't know, 6 to 10 inches that the back end dropped, and we were just like, you actually felt it, like, pull you backwards. And then we kind of, like, went into shock. We're like, what? And we looked at each other, and we both busted out the door. We looked back first, saw nothing, and we came out the door. We were thinking maybe it was the next shift coming on, the overnight shift, the midnight to 8 guys. But nobody was out there. It was just me and Sergeant Diaz. Yeah, so that was an eye-opener for both of us. But we had I didn't have Bigfoot on the brain or nothing like that. I mean, you know, it never really dawned on me. I always thought, oh, it's just a TV show. Oh, it's just out west, or, you know. I never thought it was something in a suit. It looked too good to be a suit, but I figured I was just out there by you guys. I thought that was your problem. I didn't know we had them here.
Yeah, no, I hear you. I hear you.
Well, Eric, it's been a pleasure talking with you. Thanks so much, man, for coming on.
Hey, yeah, thanks for having me on, dude. I'm a big fan, and I've got a lot of people listening to you now. So spread the word, brother. Spread the word for all you guys, all you, like, I don't know, researchers or just, you know, people who believe, or the knowers, I should say. I'm definitely a knower. You know, people ask, do you believe in Bigfoot? I'm like, no, I believe in Bigfoot, or I know in Bigfoot. I know they exist. I've seen them. I've dealt with them. I've had experiences that nothing else, it couldn't be anything else, because you're so far in the woods in the middle of nowhere. Who's going to follow you out there? So, all right, brother, you have a good night, man. And I'm going to keep listening. I'll be, as the shows come out, I'll be supporting you, brother.
Thanks, Eric. And that's it for tonight, everyone. Remember, if you've had an encounter and you'd like to be on the show, shoot me an email. My email address is wes@sasquatchchronicles.com. If you get a chance, check out the website, sasquatchchronicles.com. Become a member, help support the show. Until next time, everyone, have a great night. Have a great weekend. So moon is a human and